This is how our shack looked like. Our setup was pretty simple to the craft K2 radio. So we had the KP500 amplifier, and we had the 1 kW 2 amplifier. We had 2 laptops and bandfield filters. And the room was pretty comfortable. We had the air conditioning. The main reason we wanted air conditioning is because that helps keep the mosquitoes that carry malaria away from our room, and that was one of the concerns that we had. Although we were taking medication and had the right shots before we went to Somalia. We did quite a bit of planning for our antennas, beverages for North America, for Japan, and this is pictures for, taken using Google Earth that we used to plan our antenna setup before we even went to Somalia. We asked the hotel manager to send us pictures of the hotel at different angles. He complied, it was very helpful, but at a certain point in time he got a bit suspicious of the different pictures that we wanted from different angles of the hotel. He, even to the day we left Somalia, he didn't believe that we were there for fun. He was actually arguing with the ministry person that helped us that it can't be that anybody comes to Somalia for fun. Wires and so forth. Yeah, obviously, it was pretty difficult to keep a low profile. You can only imagine a bunch of Westerners running wires along the fence and installing black boxes, meaning beverage antenna boxes, along the walls in the war in the war zone. So it was pretty difficult. We had our antennas, of course, did not arrive with us. The airline crew said that they were too big, but in the end, after about a few days, the ministry person that helped us made some phone calls, and he was able basically to talk to the airline, and the airline felt guilty, and they basically loaded our antennas in a truck, and the truck crossed the border overnight that day and brought us the antennas. I was very skeptical that he could solve this problem, but he said that everything is possible. You know, $100 and a willing trucker will definitely cross two small bags across the border. So we had backup dipoles, and we used those for a few days, mostly obviously worked in Europe and Japan. They work really well. You know, a dipole on a tall building works really well. So we took advantage of that until we got our main antennas. Our main antennas were a big IR vertical, and it's the picture here on the top of the roof of the hotel. Worked great, and although it was very windy, you know, any structure that's high up in the air will get a lot more wind than at the surface level, so we had to fix it a few times, but nothing major. Ken brought his mostly portable antenna for three bands plus the work bands, and we had a lot of fun. These worked really well. The biggest issue was installing beverages. We had big plans to install two beverages. One beverage for North America, one for Japan, or Asia, I should say, and then beverages on the ground and so forth. That was quite a challenge. We installed the antennas, usually we had to install them outside the fence of the hotel. So what you see there is the fence of the hotel. It's a quite a high concrete fence. And you know, we installed them during the day, during the prayer time, when it was a little bit quiet and we drew less attention. Unfortunately, by the time we got to use it, the antenna never worked. The next day we checked and the antenna would just disappear. Sometimes the boxes, sometimes the wire. Prior to leaving to the expedition, I bought some very expensive wire from Germany with the Kevlar jacket. This is the kind of wire that you can never, you know, break with your own hands or even cut. But supposedly somebody had an idea how to do it. After about 3 days of trying to install beverages, we just gave up. And But we were able to install an 80-meter inverted L antenna, and that worked great. We made quite a few contacts with that. It was inverted L using the height of the building, and as you see, the SWR worked great with elevated verticals. Safety was one of the most important issues for us, and although we were offered to go somewhere outside the city with a house that had, would give us the ability to install more antennas and avoid the noise that we had in the hotel, we had to cancel that plan because of safety reasons. We can only get about two soldiers to keep us safe, so we decided that to be safe and then stay at our hotel. Common sense was the best tool to use. If we were told not to do so, then we wouldn't. At some point in time, we wanted to install antennas during the night, and the soldier said, if you want to go, go, but we're not going to go with you. Our biggest issue was noise. This is a picture of the noise that we had. About 6 o'clock in the afternoon, the stadium across the street will turn on their lights, and that will cause an incredible amount of noise between 6 in the afternoon till midnight. You can see here a picture on the right is the stadium lights, probably bad quality electronics or something, but for those 6 hours, which are prime time for US or North America, we couldn't do anything. I mean, when the noise is just 9 plus 30, you can't even attempt to do anything. So we did the best we could with what we had. This is our person that helped us a lot from their government. He was trying to help us in such a way so we go home and tell people that Somalia is changing and more teams will come in and work pilots from his country. This is how the license looks like, and we have the invitation from the government. A few statistics from CloudLog. We did about 70,000 QSOs, most of them in CW because the propagation was really not good. We did about 1,000 SSB QSOs and the first FT8 QSOs from Somalia. We had some equipment failures, so we couldn't do more than that, but we always had pileups, so that wasn't really an issue. The best bands were 20 meters and 70 meters, and because of the noise, we couldn't work more than 10% North America. It was really tough to work North America, but we gave 26% of people that worked us got an all-time view on, and that was nice. Quite a few, 60% got a new band. Got a lot of sponsors. One of the most important things that I want to tell you is that we paid for this expedition from our own pocket. Everything that we received as donations and TSL cards went to Doctors Without Borders, which left Somalia in 2013 and then returned in 2017. And all the money that we earned from donations were sent to Doctors Without Borders. On the right is a letter thanking us for the funds. It's, I don't know if you can see, it's $11,350. Quite a bit of money, and they were really thankful for that. For those of you that were lucky enough to work us, we had a nice PSL card. This is about it. I guess, I don't know if I have a minute for questions, but if there are any, we'll do.
Any questions?
Any questions? Yeah, go ahead.
What would you do differently should you go back?
We have to look for another location that's safe but with no noise. We could have done a lot more than 70,000. And I could do 1,000 here so very easily. So, anything else? Yes?
What's your next expedition?
Well, no, the expedition next. I'm getting ready for WRTC, and that's quite a bit of work. Anything else? Going once, going twice. Thank you, guys. And,
Well, next up, we've got the expedition of the year.